Happy Sabbath. As I was listening and watching them play, not too long ago, they were just little guys. It's been an honor and privilege to watch them grow up to be become men. And not just men, but men of God. Happy Sabbath.
Now, if you've heard that my
is the revolution of those determined to be free. We've talked about the book of Exodus means to exit out of bondage, out of Egypt, out of this great empire that was holding them captive. Now, when Joni asked me, I knew Joni was doing the children's story this week. I did not know Joni's story. And as I was in the school, she comes up to me and she goes, "Pastor John, do you know how to unlock handcuffs?" And a little red flag went up. And she goes, "Are you concerned?" "Well, I mean, a little bit." "Yes, I know how to unlock handcuffs. But how interesting how I'm preaching on bondage." And she really gave a sermon on how to be free from that bondage. And it was interesting. It was not planned. But as I carried the bags out for her, isn't that what Jesus does with us? If we give him our sins, we submit ourselves. Submit is not a bad word. If we die to self and say, "Lord, these are my baggage," Jesus picks them up and carries them away. So here in Exodus, one of the most dramatic scenes plays out. A showdown between God and Pharaoh, probably the most powerful man at that time. Not realizing he was meeting the most powerful God of all time. The Hebrew nation was in bondage. They were in captivity and they were not free to leave. Furthermore, they were not free to worship. Worship is going to be a theme you're going to hear today. Worship. They were not free to worship. And they were not forgotten by God. Because God remembers his covenant. The strongest word for a promise is covenant. God remembers his covenant. Not only does God remember his covenant with us, God honors it and honors his covenant with us. He hasn't forgotten. Maybe 400 years have gone by. Maybe being in bondage, they thought, well, maybe God has forgotten us. Maybe being around all the other gods of the Egyptians, they had hundreds of gods. Maybe they thought, God had forgotten, but he had not. The God of the Israelites, known as Yahweh, Lord, Jehovah, I like the great I am, the one true God, was commanding the release of his people. I didn't say asking the release. I say God was commanding the release of his people. My favorite president, the great Abraham Lincoln, the 16th president of the United States, said this, quote, "Those who deny freedom to others deserve it not for themselves, and under a just God cannot long retain it." Brothers and sisters, we serve a just God. The Egyptians, however, were a polytheistic people. They believed in multiple gods. If you looked up and Googled Egyptian gods, it would go on and on with all these crazy pictures and faces, pictures of frogs on top of human bodies, pictures of all kinds of different things. Yahweh was going to deliver his people from bondage. He could have done it with a single act or even a single word. But God chose to deliver his people through 10 different plagues to display his power over the other professed gods. In Exodus 9, verse 13 and 14, it says this. Here's the theme again. "Let my people go so they may worship me." God is speaking here. "Or this time I will send the full force of my plagues against you, against your officials, against your people, so that you may know there is no one like me in all the earth." So now Pharaoh's question is often what I hear today. It's not much different. You know, I often wonder why I come to church at John, why does gladness hit? John 10:10, we know the devil. We define the players. If I'm talking to a group of people and I say, these are the players in the Bible, the devil is going to steal, kill, and destroy, it says in John 10. But God says, I have come to give you life, and I'm a life, abundant life. But with calamities hit, good things can come from that. Because guess what? Then we realize we have a need. So often people in their 20s, 30s, and 40s have their health. Sometimes their financial success. They're getting married. Nothing wrong with getting married. They have their nice cars and nice houses. They're going to say, I don't need God. Who is this Jehovah? And why should I worship him? In my Sabbath school class today, Lyndon Cook made a really strong point, and I have to share it with you today. He says, the hierarchy of needs, we need air to live. If you hold your breath, you're going to pass out some points. We need food to survive. Now, we in America have way too much food and probably don't need as much as we eat, but we do need some food to survive. Do you agree with me? And we need water. Bodies, our hearts, how much of our bodies are made of water? Amazing amount, depending on our size and our age. Then he twisted it and said, symbolically, what is the food? As a class, we said, the word, the bread of life. What is the water in the Bible? The living water, Jesus Christ. What is the air to breathe? The Holy Spirit is just taking things. So often I wonder when we look around, who's convicted and who's not. My question is, what are they eating today? Are we so focused on what the world offers, or are we focused on what God offers? Are we focused on what God has to offer? The first condition of deliverance for freedom is obedience. That's right, obedience. When I say obedience, what comes to mind? Is it something good? You know, we as parents, we really like it when our kids obey. And when you get a little bit older, you realize the things that we ask of you as loving parents is really to protect you and to help you, right? Obedience. Pharaoh said, who is this Jehovah that I should obey his voice? I know not. Neither will I obey. The war's on. Whose side do you want to hear? Moses is showing God's people that obedience to God was the first condition of deliverance. So when I say obedience, what came to your mind? Maybe the fifth commandment, Exodus 20:12, honor thy father, obey thy father and mother, that thy days may be long.
Who's obedience to the book?
gentleness, and self-control. Open your Bible with me to Deuteronomy 28. God is a God of love. He is a God of forgiveness. He is a God of restoration. But He's also a God of obedience. Deuteronomy 28. Reminds me of the title, Blessings on Obedience. Now it's going to pass. Verse 1. If you would lightly obey the voice of the Lord your God, observe carefully all His commandments, which I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all nations on earth, and His blessings shall come upon you and overtake you because you obey the voice of the Lord your God. This Saturday, I invite you to read all these blessings God bestows upon us. But continue reading the whole chapter, because there's also consequences for disobeying God. Remember when God called Moses from the burning bush in chapter 3, verse 4. Moses said three pivotal words. He said, "Here I am." He didn't say, "Here I go." He said, "Here I am." And if you go back to the earlier generations with Abraham and Jacob, where the promise was to free God's people, they said in Genesis 22:1 and Genesis 46:2, they said the same thing, "Lord, here I am." Don't forget the promise later on in life, Isaiah and Samuel, who also repeated, "Here I am, Lord." Furthermore, the Lord said to me. So we studied in my prior sermon about the water turning into blood. It's going back to Exodus chapter 8. The water turning into blood we talked about. And a quick refresher on that was the first plague, turning the Nile to blood, was a judgment against the god Apis. The god of the Nile also heard the god of Akhenaten. There were many different gods of the Nile. Pharaoh was told, "By this you will know that I am the Lord." So God turned the water to blood where they bathed, where they drank, where they cooked their food. They had to dig by the side to get any water. The next one, if you look with me, Exodus 8, verse 2. The next plague. "If you refuse to let them go, behold, I will smite all your territory with frogs, so that the river," verse 3, "shall bring forth frogs abundantly, which shall go up and come into your house, into your bedroom, on your bed, in the houses of your servants, on your people, into the ovens, into your kneading bowls. And the frogs shall come upon you and your people and all servants." The second plague, bringing these amphibians in throughout the whole land, hippity hocks, all over God. People, this plague, the first three plagues, hit both God's people and the Egyptians. Isn't clear whether the consequences and the ramifications were the same for God's people, but the first three plagues did hit the frogs with one of them. God was making a mockery out of pets. The god, the frog, the goddess of fertility. If you look that god up from the Egyptians, it was a human body with a frog head on it. Brothers and sisters, whenever God brings the judgment, and I hear people say, "Well, I don't want to serve a god like that." What kind of god do you want to serve? I want a fair god. I want a god that forgives me. I want a god that heals me. I want a god who says I can cast all my cares upon Him and He cares for me. But whenever God brings a judgment, remember this, God also brings a way of salvation. We can focus on the judgments, but we really should start walking towards the salvation. Whenever God brings a judgment, in fact, Noah, in the days of Noah, also be the coming of the Son of Man, right? In Matthew 24. There was judgment coming. The flood was on its way. But God provided salvation if they would walk into the ark. God was willing to fight for His people in extraordinary ways. So what was the purpose of the plagues? The Bible commentary says this. The spirit of prophecy says, before the infliction of each plague, Moses was to describe in nature and effects that the king may save himself and save his people if he so chose. Every punishment rejected would be followed by a more severe until his proud heart would be humbled and he would acknowledge the maker of heaven and earth as a true and living God. The Lord would give the Egyptians an opportunity to see how vain was their wisdom of their mighty men and how feeble the power of their gods, who opposed the commands of Jehovah. Did you hear about the burglar that broke into the house? He starts shining light around the house. Seeing no one, he starts putting things in his bag and takes. But the devil does, right? He told them this morning. They said, the devil's attacking him. I said, they're right. The devil is attacking him. Because he's come to steal. He's come to kill and destroy. If you're under attack, that's probably a good thing. It means you're probably doing something good for the Lord. Seeing no one, he keeps putting things into his bag. And then he hears, God is watching. God is watching. He's looking around. He doesn't see anything. He keeps putting things into his back and he hears. God is watching. God is watching. This time as he looks around with his flashlight, he sees in a cage a parrot. And he says to the parrot, "Who are you?" The bird answered, "I'm Moses." I have no greater joy than to know my children walk in truth. They have looking at him.